not to be served, but to serve. And give your life that we might live. This is our God, the servant's King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant's King. There in the garden of tears, my heavy load He chose to bear. His heart with sorrow was torn, yet not my will but Yours He said. Servant's King, He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant King. Come see His hands and His feet, the scars that speak of sacrifice, hands that flung stars into space, to cruel nails surrendered. This is our God, the servant's King. He calls us now to servant King. So let us learn how to serve, and in our lives enthrone Him. Each other's needs to prefer, for it is Christ we serve. This is our God, the servant King. He calls us now to follow Him, to bring our lives as a daily offering of worship to the servant King. This is our God. Servant's King.
What has God been doing in the world? A cynic might say, in this year of a pandemic which has killed thousands and rendered the economies of the world impotent to cope, that God has been on the back foot, silent even, and that this gives credence to the idea that He's not really there at all. But people of faith take a different view. There's an old hymn, it's a favorite of mine, called Workman of God. It was written by Frederick William Faber, and it includes these carefully constructed lines. Workman of God, oh, lose not heart, but learn what God is like. And on the darkest battlefield thou shalt know where to strike. Thrice blessed is he to whom is given the instinct that can tell that God is on the field when he is most invisible. Do you feel that God has been invisible? Maybe you have evidence of some really hard things that have happened to you in the last year, which might at first sight support that view. Well, I choose to believe that, invisible or not, he continues to be present with us. So it is to this invisible but actively present God we turn to by faith. He is made plain in the person of Jesus Christ and made continually present in the person of God the Holy Spirit. And so let us pray. Lord, all your riches of wisdom and knowledge are hidden in Christ. You reveal them to us through the word spoken in his name. Enable us to see today what has been done for our redemption, so that Christ may live in our hearts by faith and be proclaimed in our lives by grace displayed. May the gospel be to us more than words. May we be a people of strong convictions, wedded to the truth, broken for our land and its people, committed to the cause of Christ's kingdom, and determined to see him honored. We think of the church. We think of her as your people, for this is how you have described it, Christ's body, at least a foretaste of your new creation. Christ's bride, his perfect partner in the making. Christ's building, your temple where you live by your Spirit. Sometimes, Lord, it is true the lives of Christians do put the world to shame by their selfless and lovely presence in this place of tears, and for this we're glad. But sometimes it is true the lives of Christians make it hard for people to see Jesus, and for this we are ashamed and truly sorry. As we consider this drawing together of a broken world, virus-ridden and sick, with the vibrancy of a church filled with your Spirit and brimming with life, we pray that one might be a blessing to the other, and that you might be a blessing to both. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Isaiah chapter 7, verses 10 to 17. Again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask the Lord your God for a sign, whether in the deepest depths or in the highest heights." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." Then Isaiah said, "Hear now, you house of David. Is it not enough to try the patience of men? Will you try the patience of my God also? Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. He will eat curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. But before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid to waste. The Lord will bring on you and on your people and on the house of your father a time unlike any since Ephraim broke away from Judah. He will bring the king of Assyria."
During the Advent season, we typically read the Old Testament prophecies about Jesus and create a link between them and the events of Jesus' life. And today we have a great example of that in Isaiah chapter 7, which is directly quoted in Matthew's Gospel chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. In Matthew's Gospel we read this: "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, 'The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel,' which means God with us." So far, so familiar. But let's look today at the original words of that prophecy and maybe approach it with fresh eyes. Isaiah speaks of the judgment of God upon his own people. He is almost a contemporary of another great prophet who was doing a similar thing. His name was Amos. So we have two kingdoms divided by power politics, Judah and Israel. And we have two prophets, Isaiah and Amos, united by God's displeasure at both of these kingdoms. In fact, for just under 200 years, these two divided kingdoms have compromised the mission of God in the world. They have, almost comically, missed the point of their existence. The people of God were, of course, chosen originally to be light bearers to the nations around them, evangelists, if you will, to the world at large. But they misread this calling. They misinterpreted God's call to them as a sign of God's special favor upon them. And they greedily absorbed the blessings of God for themselves, rather than selflessly giving away the blessings of God to everyone else. Now, inevitably, with this deficient gospel, they came to believe that God was on their side, that he was one of them, and this led them in both kingdoms, north and south, Israel and Judah, into a form of national state religion, which of course Jehovah would not tolerate for a moment. The rot had well and truly set in. So what is God to do about this? In one part of this story, you have kings who will apparently do anything to hold on to their political and economic power and only pay the merest lip service to the Lord. While on the other hand, you also have God's prophets who are speaking truth to power and not always being tolerated for their faithfulness to this task. There's tension in the room. Now, Isaiah is called to be a prophet in this difficult space and in these momentous times. And we want to look at a prophecy that he gave to a very young and inexperienced king of Judah, who had neither the nous nor the common sense, and indeed lacked the maturity to see his shortcomings. He was, after all, only 20 years old, and his name was Ahaz. His story is told in chapter 7 and 8 of Isaiah, and also, more fully perhaps, in 2 Kings chapter 16. Now the background is this. Jerusalem is under threat of invasion in what looks to be a brewing civil war with their cousins in the northern kingdom of Israel. Now the reasons are complex, we don't need to go into them in detail for now, but this is blue-on-blue warfare, Israel versus Judah. And this young and inexperienced king Ahaz of Judah, little more than a teenager really, panics, and that's probably understandable. But Isaiah, God's prophet, says to him, look, hold on. God is going to send you a sign if you look to him in this moment of crisis. When a forest is destroyed by a fire, all that remains are stumps of the trees. That's what's left behind. So let's follow the sequence of what Isaiah said to this young king as he offered him his advice. Isaiah says that the stumps of firewood that are this invading force are really just that. They're just firewood, nothing more serious, verse 4. Then he says, don't lose heart because of these two smouldering stumps of firewood. Judah will not be ruined by this threatened civil war and invasion. But Ahaz, you really do need to trust God at this moment of testing. Then he says, if you do not stand firm in your faith, you won't stand at all, verse 9. Well, Ahaz is still wavering and terribly unsure of himself, so Isaiah follows this up and says, ask the Lord your God for a sign. But Ahaz refuses rather piously and says, I will not put the Lord to the test. Well, all right, says Isaiah, don't push me on this because, like it or not, the Lord is giving you a sign, and here it is. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and will call him Emmanuel, verse 14. The word that's used for virgin here is a young woman of an age to marry, and the word Emmanuel, of course, means, because we're very familiar with it, God with us. Now this immediately presents us with a conundrum, because we read these words as Christians, and we do so in the 21st century, and we also do so because we have read Matthew chapter 1. It's quoted there in Matthew's Gospel, and so we instantly associate this verse with Mary and the boy Jesus, who was God's Emmanuel. And we read it at Christmas each year, and rightly so, because the prophecy is surely fulfilled in him, as Matthew said it would be. But my question is, what do we miss if this is the first, or indeed the only thing that we do with this text in Isaiah? Yes, it's true, the text does lead us to Christmas. But what of the journey that the story takes through the centuries before it arrives there? That's the great joy and satisfaction of reading a book like Isaiah, because we're able to ask the question, what can these words have meant to their first hearer, who in this case was a young and panicking king, and his name was Ahaz? They were spoken to him in the first place, and he was in a very tight spot and didn't know what to do, facing this military and political crisis of an invasion task force about to pile in on top of him and trying to manage it all on his own and using his own resources of wisdom and insight. More than that, the prophecy continues beyond the promise of a baby son, because it says that before this boy who is to be born has grown enough to be able to say mummy and daddy, Assyria, the big economic and military power of the region, is going to pour in upon Judah. Now that's a whole different and new ballgame. That is not civil war with a neighbor like Israel. That is guaranteed annihilation. So how are we to read this? Well, the answer is that there was an immediate fulfillment of the prophecy which Isaiah gave. And it came through not Mary and Joseph, but Isaiah himself and his young wife. Ben Walker is going to read chapter 8, verses 1 to 4, which describes the birth of their son.
Isaiah chapter 8, verses 1 to 4. The Lord said to me, take a large scroll and write on it with an ordinary pen, Maher Shalal Hashbaz. And I will call in Uriah the priest and Zechariah, son of Jeberechiah, as reliable witnesses for me. Then I went to the prophetess, and she conceived and gave birth to a son. And the Lord said to me, name him Maher Shalal Hashbaz, before the boy knows how to say my father or my mother, the wealth of Damascus and the plunder of Samaria will be carried off by the king of Assyria.
Being the dramatist that he was, Isaiah made a large poster for Ahaz to see. The poster had the words Maher Shalal Hashbaz written on it, which means quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil. Now, these are military words. They refer to what happens after an invasion, and it's not pretty. The conquering army will be able to plunder the land that they have taken, and they will be able to remove its wealth as the spoils of war. So this big poster with its ugly threat of military catastrophe is displayed for everyone to see. And this young king Ahaz must have been trembling in his boots. Is this what is going to happen to us? Are we about to be plundered? It certainly gets his attention. Now, after this great dramatic prophetic moment, some months go by. Isaiah goes home to his wife, who conceives, and in due time, they have a son together. I remember the fun which Zoe and I had choosing names for our kids. Some of the names were chosen simply because we liked them, and others because they had a deep connection with grandparents or even further back in our families. Names are significant. Well, what about this for a name for your son? Quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil. I wonder what he was called in the playground at school. Blitzkrieg? But can you imagine the message heading home to King Ahaz? As 9 months after that poster was initially shown to him, news of the birth and the naming of the child reaches him. The clock is ticking, and he remembers the prophecy. Before this child can say, mummy or daddy, Assyria is going to arrive in power and swallow you up. You're in trouble, my boy, and you have big decisions to make. Isn't it true that all of us reach moments of crisis in our lives when big decisions are needed? We need to tease out what really matters to us in those moments, to understand what, for example, is a matter of principle and what is simply a matter of opinion. And so we make our minds up about what to do, and we press on, hopefully having made solid and sensible and enduring decisions. Now, sadly, in this critical moment when Ahaz needed to go through this careful and wise process of discernment, he jumps the wrong way. Instead of trusting God and seeking his face, as Isaiah said he must do, he does the worst of all things. He tries to make peace with his implacable foe. He actually goes to Assyria and welcomes them in. 2 Kings chapter 16 describes his complete capitulation to Assyria, to its life and to its culture and values. Ahaz goes so far as to restructure the temple along Assyrian lines. He actually imports an altar from their pagan religion and sets it up in the Lord's temple. He even allows child sacrifice to take place there. Actually, he sacrifices his own son to the pagan god Molech. He goes further and cripples the economy of Judah by paying huge tribute money to the Assyrians just to keep them sweet. His lack of spiritual discernment and leadership is a complete disaster and, incidentally, provides the backdrop for the ministry of the prophet Micah to speak into. It's so bad that Isaiah leaves the ministry of the word for a time because it has become completely impossible for him to continue. So, back to the prophecy. The virgin will conceive and bear a son, and you're to call him Emmanuel. What do we do with it? Was it fulfilled in the birth of Isaiah's oddly named son, quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil, the blitzkrieg kid? Well, yes, it was. Could it also have been fulfilled in the birth of Jesus of Nazareth to the young girl Mary? Well, yes, it was. And that's one of the mysterious and wonderful things about the work of the Holy Spirit in this book, the Bible. I wonder if you've been to the beach where you see a cliff face that the sea has cut away. You can see layers or strata of rock, one on top of the other. And as each layer is laid down, it becomes part of the one that went before and will in turn become part of the one to follow. Well, so it is with prophecy. God is sculpting the entire cliff face, using the events of history as his medium. It's part of what we mean when we refer to him as the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He sees both ends of history at the same time. Yes, Jesus is the fulfillment of this prophecy. And the challenge and the demand he brings is just as potent today as it was in the day of Ahaz. And the disaster that awaits us if we jump the wrong way is just as catastrophic as it was for him. Emmanuel, God with us, is not always a comfortable word, nor perhaps is it best displayed by romantic scenes from a straw-filled stable in Palestine. It's harder than that. It's more challenging than that. His presence amongst us draws responses from us that are sometimes tough. His arrival among us has a timeless application and finds its level in each generation where we're presented with our crises and our challenges to spiritual integrity in our moment of time. The question is, which way are we going to jump when we're called to discern his will? One of the nice things that a moderator gets to do each year is choose a Christmas card to be sent to a variety of people. This year, I chose a photograph for the card. It was taken by Philip McRae, who is one of our ministers in North Belfast. The picture is of a street in Krakow in Poland. And this is what I wrote inside the card, along with the scripture, John chapter 1, verse 14, superimposed on the photograph itself. So the Word became human and made his home among us. The picture shows a deserted street, as if the city of Krakow is in lockdown. The mood is overwhelmingly dark. The cobbles are in keeping with the buildings, old enough to reach back in time to a past which included the Krakow ghetto and Auschwitz, a mere 30 miles distant. The buildings on one side of the street show signs of long-term neglect, in contrast to those opposite, which are well-maintained, even prosperous. This is a place of stark inequalities. The street leads to a destination. It is a place of light, hinting at open spaces beyond, with perhaps some trees. But before this, there is a gate, and the structure of the gate is a cross. In making his home among us, Christ inhabited the darkest spaces of the human story. In joining us here in the dark, he would draw us inexorably towards the light. The cost to him was everything. The benefit to us was our healing. Emmanuel, God with us, means that his kingdom is among us, and that as his people we are expected to live with kingdom principles in place, whether our story is in Judah 700 years before Jesus, the ghettos of Eastern Europe in the 1940s, or the lockdown of a virus-ridden world in the present day. Our enemy in these days may well be compromise, such as tempted King Ahaz for a quiet life. Compromise with politicians who overreached themselves in the name of a corrupt ideology, as in the history of Krakow. Or compromise to the siren call of secularism to replace God with some other godlet on the throne, as in our own day. Listen to the message of the prophet, and do not bargain with the enemy, but stand firm, and having done all, stand. That is our calling. And if we reach the end of our Christian road and we're still standing faithful, he will say to us, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter in to the joy of your Lord." Amen. And so we pray for other people. Let us pray. Lord, in these days, we pray for church leaders, for ministers, pastors, elders, and those who lead us. Be their strength in these days of rapid change. We pray for theologians and writers who, by their gifts of intellect and spiritual reflection, will help us to understand the times in which we're living. We pray for influencers in our culture, people who run corporations, write articles, own businesses, and make us think. Catch their attention in these days of flux, that they might know the limits of their own powers. We pray for people whom we might consider to be weak or vulnerable, the elderly and people for whom social distancing has become a byword for loneliness and isolation. May we be the means of drawing them back into our community. We pray for our congregation as we look forward to the coming months, wondering what they might hold for us. Bless us as we seek to be wise and obedient to your command and call to serve. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name.
And now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.